I do have the content to deliver here in this video. So for those of you who are still enjoying this, I'm enjoying it more than ever, actually. It's become richer and richer and richer and richer and richer. Let me just get right to the point. October 21st, 2015. October 21st, 2015. This happens to be right in the middle of the Bonn Conference, which is the final conference. This, the great funneling effort of the United Nations into the Paris Climate Talks, which will then funnel out to the entire world, ultimately. This is it. So, October 21st is right in the middle of that. Now, what significance is October 21st, 2015? The Holy Spirit showed it to me last night as I was digging, researching. I never stopped working. It is the 50th anniversary, the golden anniversary, the great jubilee. There's a jubilee. Every 50 years, a jubilee also. Biblically, the jubilee is a 50th year golden anniversary. That date, what happened 50 years ago on that date? Any ideas? No. Okay. I wouldn't have known either unless I said, wow. On that date, October 21st, 1965, at Columbia University, I believe it was at Columbia University in New York, it was in New York for sure, Helen Schuckman heard an inner voice, as it were, said, "This is A Course in Miracles, please take notes, please take notes." Okay, and this was the beginning of the most important salvational transmission the world has ever had, in my opinion. And I'm sticking to that opinion, okay? A Course in Miracles. 50 years later, October 21st, this is a very significant date, and it happens right smack in the middle of this Bonn Climate Change Conference, Forum Conference on Climate Change, United Nations Conference on Climate Change, CCC, UNFCCC. I'm getting used to all this acronyms of the United Nations. They love acronyms. God bless them. God bless all of us. Okay. Because it's all okay. The A Course in Miracles, I read somewhere someone is very erudite about Eastern teachings, all this stuff, and he wrote this long essay on A Course in Miracles, and he got it completely wrong, which is okay, because, you know, I'm sure if he went back and spent more time at, he'd revise it. So we don't have to hold one another to our perspectives, right? I mean, forgive our perspectives, because ultimately we're going towards a higher perspective, which A Course in Miracles is aiming us towards that. But you have to do the work. You know, it can't just like, it can't do it for you. I mean, we have to do the work. So if you don't put anything into it, of course, it's going to come back to you like, oh, there's not much there. Dualistic, you know. This is like the great Yanis, I think. Didn't Rama Maharshi say there? Someone said that yeah, yeah, Rama Maharshi said that a great Yani, you get it's like a mirror, it just reflects back to you. What you're sending to them is just reflected back to you. They're not trying to change anything or do anything, all right, in that way. Same with A Course in Miracles. You get out of it what you put into it. It reflects back to you. And so for me, it's the ultimate transmission that we've had. Because I put so much into it. I was willing to put so much into it, you see. If you're not, it somehow got my willingness going. This is huge. This is what we all need, is willingness to get going. And start putting the effort into it. This is the grace. This is the grace of God. If we don't have willingness, motivation, willingness, the grace isn't active there. So I don't pay attention to what other people say about A Course in Miracles. I just can't happen to come across this one instance. Yeah, and I come across occasionally. But I don't pay much attention because that just reflects what they've put into it. I know what I've gotten out of it. And I'm very pleased with what I've got managed to get out of it. All in all, I mean, I don't study the book so much anymore. But it's the momentum that has been generated. So the 50th anniversary, what do you think Jesus is going to do on this 50th anniversary? It's very significant. 50 years is a significant milestone. And how in the world, you know, how could it be coincidence that smack dab in the middle of this 5-day period, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, that's 5 days, if the 21st is smack in the middle of the Bonn UNFCCC conference, which is designed to finalize the fundamental legal structure of what all the nation, the whole globe, is going to agree upon governmentally as the roadmap to tackling climate change, which is really tackling the environment, which is really what all the leaders are saying is a mandate for everyone on the planet now. And the doomsdayers are saying, well, it's already too late, the world is toast, you know. So they have this extreme pressure on them, right? 50th anniversary, how, you know, this it's striking, isn't it? I googled Jesus climate change. Has he said anything on climate? No. Has he said anything on the environment? No. And we might think, wow, you know, what's going on here? Okay. There's a lot going on right now. It is a super, 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 super intense time. I'm fine. I'm surfing it, surfing the wave. Now, the job of the listener is to listen. You don't have to explain it to anyone. You don't have to explain. You don't have to understand it to explain it. It's enough to hear it and get familiar with it. Only those who are particularly keyed to express it will be expressing truth here. It takes a severe commitment. You have to be keyed that way, as it were. But that's okay. I would say, when you hear truth, say, this is neither... Truth has its own ringtone. It is neither the ringtone of sanity that we're used to, nor the ringtone of insanity. You will not hear truth in any university in this world. Neither will you hear it in any insane asylum in this world, mental hospital. You will not hear it there either. Okay. You will not hear truth in any church in this world, nor will you hear it in any discotheque in this world, or nightclub or bar. Okay? Absolutely, you will not hear it. The only place you hear truth is from those who are particularly keyed to give it out. That's it. And it has its own ringtone. To use a good metaphor, you'll say, this doesn't sound like sanity, but nor does it sound like insanity. This is neither sanity nor insanity. What is this? You see, truth is not based on anything at all. It's not based on the absence of lies. Okay, this is very crucial to understand this. It is not, to hear this, it is, and get familiar with it. It is not based on the absence of lies. It is not based on the absence of anything, nor is it based on the non-absence of anything. Truth is neither based on absence nor non-absence. Truth is. This is just the way we can express it. It just is. Truth is not even based on truth. Okay? It just is. It's not derivative in any way. Which is why we can't really explain it, right? Because we always explain is derivatives. All concepts are derivative. Basically, so don't worry about explaining it when you're hearing. Just say, okay, this is very interesting. It's like you come across something and say, I've never come across this before. What is this? This is very interesting. Why haven't I ever come across this? Wow. Quite extraordinary. Let me pay some attention to this. And just sort of take it like that. Because again, it's not based on a derivative at all. Now, I'll say something quite extraordinary here. The environment, okay. Both the environmental problems, okay, that and the effort to solve them. The effort to solve environmental problems is actually doubling down on insanity. It's actually doubling down on it. Environmental problems, it's insanity. Yeah, it's insanity. Trying to fix them is doubling down on insanity. It's going to make it much worse. The insanity that we're suffering from. But we're letting them say something else. We're not really suffering from insanity. Okay. And again, truth has its own ringtone. Don't try to put it into sanity or insanity. It's not based on either one. It's not based on anything. It's just truth is true and nothing else is true. Any and all circumstances and situations, including environmental problems, including the attempt to solve environmental problems, any and all circumstances and situations inherently have to be fake, have to be complete pretense, complete fakery, okay? The God, the Prime Creator, extended itself as God the Prime Creator, God the Father, God the Son, as absolute perfect freedom, which can't possibly ever confront any circumstance or situation. It's totally impossible. There is no bindingness between moment, instants. There's just the now instant. That's it. So there can't possibly be, say, well, this is a circumstance or this is a situation, because Spirit's completely free to choose whatever it wants to choose every instant. So freedom cannot be subject to any circumstance or a situation whatsoever. So we have this world where we say there's all these circumstances, the climate, right? Now, I am not a climate change denier at all. We're talking about something totally different here. What I'm saying is I'm a world denier, absolutely. And I'm a universe denier, absolutely. This entire universe, what does it appear to us, to perception, as this massive situation of circumstances and situations? The sun sits there, the planets revolve. These are circumstances and situations, right? This is our situation. We're in a world, the sunlight, the world turns. These are like, we say, wow, we're stuck in all these circumstances and situations here, universe. The universe is totally fake, totally fake, totally fake. This world is totally fake. It doesn't exist, actually, except in our own imagination. Now, why would we be doing this? Okay, why would we be doing this? And by the way, well, I'll tell you later. As I said before, you know the answer, but I'll say it again. It's worth repeating. Why would we be imagining this massive fakery? Well, again, we want to usurp the position of Prime Creator from God, the Prime Creator. We want to usurp that. We want to be the Prime Creator. We want to be the creator of God instead of God being the creator of us. This is what we're trying to do. So what we're trying to do is we've dreamed up this scenario, which is totally different than reality. So we can say to God, hey, God, we didn't make this. Spirit couldn't possibly have made this, God, so you must have made it. If we didn't make it, you must have created it. We didn't create this, so you must have created it. So we imagine this scenario of a universe. tell God that this is God's true creation. And of course, it's vastly different than creation. Okay, totally different. So that's way we, that way we can say, well, we didn't do it. So you must, the only other option is you must have done it. So this is why the bodies and death and all these circumstances, situations, it's full of all these circumstances, situations, which have nothing to do with reality. If it was just like reality, you know, it would be easy to see that we've done it, right? That we're the ones imagining this. But we've imagined it in such a way that it seems like no way could this be from coming from us. So we're trying to deceive God into believing that this is God's handiwork, God's creation. And of course, if this was God's creation, then God couldn't possibly have created us spirit, right? You see this? If we can get God to accept this as God's creation, then we can say, well, God, guess what? You couldn't possibly have created us. So we must be the prime creator. Now, of course, you can see holes in this scam, right? Absolutely. Because if this was so, then how could we have created God? Because God would be totally different than perfection and freedom that we're claiming we're the prime creator. So it doesn't, the scam, you know, is full of holes like that. But it doesn't matter. We're trying to do it anyway. Of course it doesn't work. And so of course there's going to be holes. It's going to fall apart if you look at it. That's okay. We're just looking at it. It doesn't have to be perfect scam for us to look at it. You know, what we've been doing is delaying. Say, wait a minute. I don't want to look at it until it's a perfect scam. I don't want to look at it. It might not be perfect. That scares me. Because of our continuity fear, we want it to work. So people, we're all afraid to look at it because we say, I don't think the scam is perfect yet. We got to work on it a little bit more. So climate change is what we call circumstance. Okay, all these circumstances, you know, boatload full of world full of circumstances. Ah, the whole world is going to be destroyed, right? And then this effort to fix it is another world full of circumstances. Oh, we've got to completely change our way of life, our way of thinking, our way of acting, our focus, our intention, our efforts. Everything needs to be completely changed to change the circumstances. This is just doubling down on the scam. We say we got to keep this scam going. It's not perfect yet. Yes. So, and again, don't worry about I got to explain this to somebody. How can I explain? No, because there are. You're not going to hear this anywhere, are you? I mean, I've never heard this kind of talk anywhere. Not even in A Course in Miracles, because that was designed to get us going. It wasn't designed to encapsulate it to the ultimate extent like this. You have to work towards this. But this is an encapsulation of it. Boiling it all down, you know, to what it was really about. So I say this because I'm not hearing it anywhere else. I'm searching for it. I'd love to hear, you know, someone really talking like this. They don't talk like this. So it's unfamiliar territory to hear this. So I just say, okay, this is very interesting. I like hearing this. Either you like hearing it or not. Just make it simple. Do I like hearing this or not? If you like hearing it, then that's good enough. You just get familiar with it. And just let the wow. You know, the wow is very important. I was stuck this morning. I went back and identified the wow, got unstuck. It's like a miracle technique, actually. Really, I said, oh boy, I'm just floundered. I don't know how to get out of this. I just said, maybe I'm just in an intense wow. Let me take that. Let me give that the benefit of the doubt. That's what's going on. And then I started doing this practice. I can, I will, I already have. I've already succeeded. This is if you feel the wow so intense, you can do this. I can, I will, I've already done it. I can, I will, I've already done it. And get in this mood like I've already succeeded. And this is why I'm feeling the wow. And as soon as you start connecting this, you'll find that you are back in the driver's seat. It's like you're in this car and you say, whoa, who's driving this car? It's, oh, they're going this way, oh, this way. And suddenly you realize, I'm driving it. I got the steering wheel. Oh, it's okay. Now I can, you know, straighten out the steering a little bit. By the way, if you're suffering, quote unquote, from certain bad circumstances, you're very blessed and fortunate. As I am certainly suffering from that in many, many ways. Because otherwise, imagine if you thought you were in good circumstances, you would just continue to believe in circumstances and be pursuing good circumstances. The fact is that neither good circumstances nor bad circumstances are real in the slightest bit. Do not be pursuing good circumstances, good situations, like that. This only doubles down on insanity, doubles down on the scam. Be pursuing truth. Be pursuing truth. So if you're in bad circumstances, you don't like it, this drives you to truth. It drives you to truth. You say, wow, I just hate my world, my environment, everything. So much trouble I'm having. My gosh, this is horrible. This world's terrible. I don't like the circumstances. Then you're willing to listen. Hey, wait a minute. Is there some way to get free of circumstances? Now, there is a way. Intermediate step is the final quote-unquote circumstance, which is also an illusion. But it's a circumstance that reminds us that, oh, we created this circumstance. We're the ones believing doing this, spirit. So spirit owns the dream at that point. The death-free realm is still spirit, a dream of spirit, but it's a dream of spirit that says, hey, this is exactly like what I would create or dream about if I was spirit. And if this is what I am, then it reminds me of what God would create as perfection. And then finally you can put down the final circumstance, the death-free realm. This is a way of looking at it. Because right now we're denying that we have anything to do with all these situations and circumstances, including this world, including the universe, all this. It's as a fantasy. It's all just a fantasy. Now in the death-free realm, there's none of the circumstances that we think about in this world as far as situations, circumstances. It's just everything's perfect. Nothing has ever died. Nothing has ever been sick. Everything's just immaculately perfect. All the nature there. And we just say, wow, it's like the circumstance of no circumstances here. This is like perfection. But you still have appearance of, apparently of form and which you could say, well, that's a circumstance. But anyway, there's a workaround that the Holy Spirit has for us. There's a workaround for us. So don't be worried about this at all. We're able to set down our fantasy. We absolutely are able to do it gently with an intermediate step. We don't have to try and perfect our scam, which is what the world is trying to do. We're trying to worship time is trying to perfect the scam. And again, everyone says, well, I'll look at it as soon as we perfect it. And then I can admire it. I want to be able to admire it and say, wow, it worked. Say, sure, I'll look at it. Well, after it works, that's not the spiritual path at all. It never will be the spiritual path. So time worshiping is just delaying. It's not the spiritual path at all. So the world is not going in a spiritual direction. It's not going in the direction of truth at all. It's going in the direction of trying to find better circumstances, trying to make a better world. When you hear, let's make a better world, this is not the spiritual path. Which means let's improve circumstances and situations for everybody through, you know, through whatever means. Again, good circumstances are just as delusional as bad circumstances, with the exception of one particular, like the death-free realm or the vision of oneness, which pragmatically enables us to reckon, to make the key recognition and acceptance, oh, I dreamed the whole thing up. And I'm still perfect, and my creativity is still perfect, and so I can set it down. But we can't really explain or understand that, you know, until we have to experience it. We have to experience it. Our job is to remove the blocks from this experiencing. That's all. And then let the experiencing do its work. So truth is neither sane nor insane, actually, if you really look at it. And so don't try again to put it into this label. If you say, okay, this is sanity, I need to understand, that's going to be a problem, because you're going to try to put it into what you believe, or what we believe is sanity, which is based on completely false assumptions. It's logical, but based on false assumptions, so it doesn't work. This is why it's quite difficult to express this. It's been an uphill battle. You have to completely rework what you think, what the assumptions of sanity, while at the same time still pretending to have normal sanity in the world, so people think, oh, you're sane. And again, truth is neither sane nor insane, neither one. What we think of as sanity and insanity is all within the context of the scam that we're, this universe, which we think is the handiwork of God. Any and all situations and circumstances that we believe we're experiencing can't possibly be the handiwork of God. So it has to be our handiwork. There isn't any other option whatsoever. It has to be our handiwork. What's Jesus going to do? Or not do? On the 50th. So for me, this is a most important date. Most important date. October 21st, 2:15. Yeah, but if you can just realize the truth is neither sane nor insane, which, and then you say, well, that's okay. It's very interesting to me. It's enough for it to be very interesting. Like, I'm interested in it. Don't try to put it into some category, including good situations, good circumstances, including even sanity. Don't even try to put it there. This is where everyone fails, okay? This is what I'm seeing. Now, of course, you start out, you don't say that. Of Course in Miracles doesn't say that. That's too advanced for starting out. You know, we try to put it into sanity, and this is the struggle. But at this point, 50 years down the road, we can say this. We can say this. It's being said right now. Don't even try to put it into sanity. Neither sanity nor insanity. It doesn't fit equally. It equally doesn't fit either one, actually. Don't try to balance and say, oh, I got, how much is there? How much? No, it's something. It's its own truth. Is its own witness, you know, it's its own reference. It's not referential. Truth is not referential. And we're trying, if we try to reference it to anything at all, we're going to miss it. So we are going into a time of doubling down on insanity, doubling down on the scam. It's not insanity, it's a scam. Okay, we're not insane, actually. We're not, we're pretending. You know, you can't say someone's pretending to be insane is really insane. We cannot really say that. We're not. God, we're still perfect. We're pretending to be something different than what we really are. Trying to deceive God, but that's just a game. It's just a game. We're not really insane. Now, will we continue to seem to have circumstances? Of course, anybody in this with a body in the world, this dream figures in a dream world, will seem, you can seem to define they have circumstances. Well, I'm sitting here at the circumstance. I'm sitting here at the situation, but it's not really. It's not really, because I could not also not be sitting here the next instant, nor the previous instant. You know, I'm choosing to be sitting here this instant, and I'm choosing to be sitting here this instant, and I'm choosing to be sitting here this instant. It's an instant by instant by instant choice. So this is not really a circumstance or a situation. There isn't any such thing as a circumstance or situation. And by I mean spirit is choosing this. So, yet, you know, we just make this assumption that it is, but it's a false assumption. Anyway, we may choose some instant to be, you know, in here or there or whatever, but it's important to realize that you'll never find truth in any particular place at all. As long as you're searching for truth in a place, you won't find it. In fact, as long as you're searching for truth at all, you won't find it. So we might say, well, maybe I go to Hawaii, I can find it. No, you won't find it in Hawaii. Maybe I go to an ashram, find it. I won't find it there. Maybe I find it at university. No, you can't. Truth is not findable. As a circumstance or situation, okay? When we're searching for something, what are we searching for? And inherently, this means we're searching for a circumstance or a situation. Otherwise, how can we even talk about searching? And since truth is never a circumstance or situation, how can we find it through searching? Shifting gears here. We just let that marinate. You see, don't try to put it into sanity or insanity, all right? Again, don't even just say, ah, wow. I like the best. Just, wow. This is very interesting. Wow. And just let the wow be its own category. There's sanity, insanity, and wow. And what we're doing is we're walking together in the wow. I went back, checking dates, I was checking years. This whole back to 1981 thing is very important, actually. Very important. And so I was listening to all the songs, the Billboard Top 100 songs. And they're on YouTube, there's videos that have clips of every song that was number one during that year. I listened to 1981. Terrible. Oh my God, horrible. 1980... lousy. 1979, yuck. 78, a little better. It's like as you go back, the music seems to get better for some reason. I don't know. It was terrible in 1981. The costume, I remember that. I said, oh, no wonder why I was so difficult. Holy cow. What a weird vibe. But of course, the world's always a weird vibe, isn't it? Yeah. but the world was getting weird, really weird at that point in time. You can see it through the music. You can read the music's like a book, and just going through all these songs that were, and they showed the musicians playing the songs, so you could see all the costumes and the way they acted and everything. It was like, I said, oh my gosh, yeah, I remember that. I don't know how I survived it. And then in 1981, all hell broke loose. Personal PC computer start, you know, hooked on to people's imaginations at that point. The IBM 5150, AIDS epidemic hooked on to everyone's imagination at that point. And anyway, so I was going back and listening to all these songs. What an experience. Wow. Weren't so many good ones. were not, I was shocked. I was really shocked in that actually the music was pretty lousy. In fact, it was very lousy. I didn't see any, I really didn't see anything that was that good in all those years. It was a really, the cleverest of them all is that time is Paul McCartney. He has a knack for clever hooks and some sort of knack, which is why he's still performing and still sounding good and everything. He somehow managed to keep it, you know, go through that era and adapt to it. You know, it's just a you know, what's that coming up? What's that other song? With a little luck, we can work it out. So it's an optimistic song. We can make this whole darn thing work out. With a little dun-dun. That was the number one song. Close to, I believe, when I came upon A Course in Miracles, 1978. For the little luck, we can work that out. And then Smokey Robinson is also good. We're gonna fly away. Hope you're going my way. There's a couple of artists that stood out. But most of it was pretty rough stuff. That is like, wow, you didn't really miss anything during that time. I wasn't paying that much attention to the music. So I didn't miss much, that's for sure. So in 1978, for me, it was time to focus on A Course in Miracles, and I sort of stopped listening to music, actually, which is a very good decision, because Blondie also stood out as having a some sort of smoother vibe in some way. You know, they somehow had something. So just letting the wow, you know, marinate. What you do is you look at truth, you hear truth, and you let it marinate for a little while. Because it's just like, I never heard this before, you know? The idea is you got to challenge yourself to go further. So we hear truth, it's something we haven't heard, we're not quite familiar with, and the challenge is to keep getting more familiar with it, so it's easier and easier and easier. Now, I'm challenging myself, 50th anniversary of Jesus, basically re-establishing communication, or at least we were willing to re-establish communication 50 years ago on October 21st, it will be 50 years. Our willingness to do this. So for me, I'm trying to get familiar with what Jesus would say, you know. So it's not going to be a strain for me, or I'm not going to be in unfamiliar territory. Whatever Jesus does or doesn't do, in terms of communication and relating, I feel at least I'll be, you know, somewhat in the ballpark. And God knows, it would be a good idea if we start relating with Jesus at this point. And as some know, some are wise enough to know that we took what Jesus had to offer us before. We took that and tried to put it in a basket of assumptions that we already had. We didn't challenge those assumptions. We at least not very much. there are some that were just, you know, bedrock assumptions. We said, well, we know that this must be so. So Jesus must then be saying this because this is our assumption. So it must follow logically this assumption we have. But in doing this, Jesus' message was lost to the world. Now the ego, I don't like to talk about ego this or ego that, because it's not really how we experience the world in archetypes. We're so into images and we tend to experience stuff in terms of bodies, in terms of dynamics and stuff. But if you want to say ego, I use the term the goddess ego. You can say the goddess ego, which is the attempt to market this scam, really, is it's our own attempt to market this scam, you know, is try to make it, so we try to make it seem beautiful and attractive and imagine that it must be attractive to God, so the goddess is attractive to us because we want to believe that this whole thing is very attractive to God. So this is the representation of the universe. Here, God, here is what really represents the universe, this beautiful goddess. And this is why you can believe this must be your creation. Look, you must have created this wonderful goddess. But what happens is we end up interacting with our own marketing. And it affects us. And so this ego goddess, she says, hey, I'm here. Oh, that's great. You listen to Jesus. I'm here to help too. I'm helping Jesus out. And I say, well, wait a minute. What does Jesus need help with? He doesn't understand the truth. Oh, well, he has part of the truth and I have part of the truth and together we have the full truth. I say, whoa, wait a minute. Jesus doesn't have the full truth? Wait a minute here. And so what the goddess does, the fake goddess, okay. I'm not talking about genuine spiritual teachers who happen to have female form, but I'm talking about the archetype, a goddess archetype, the marketing, how we market this scam to God. Says, no, I'm just here to help you understand what Jesus really has to say. Okay, but the goddess represents the assumptions we have about this world, that God created this world. And so, the goddess seems to be helping us. I want you to bring you to my son, you know, help you. You don't quite understand him. So, let me just break in here for a moment because I just realized something. When I was young, I remember not reacting to good circumstances or bad. I reacted to everything in the world as circumstances pretty equally, you know, this way or that way, it doesn't really matter, right? And people said, no, you don't have it right. You're supposed to hate the bad circumstances and love the good circumstances. And that this is the big battle, you know. And as soon as you start differentiating, you fall into delusion. Little ant crawling there. Differentiating in terms of, well, good circumstances are from God and bad circumstances are from our sin. This is what I mean by differentiating. Of course you want to differentiate between fire and water or something, even though Ananda Maimon did not. So completely beyond any differentiation, so I can't even tell the difference. To me, it's all the same. But for our circumstance, let's say we're going to differentiate. Of course, at the pragmatic level, we will. But we're not saying that the good circumstances come from God and the bad circumstances come from the devil or Satan or the ego or anything like that. No, all circumstances come from equally from spirit, spirit's imagination. And that's all a scam, all of them equally. So it's this non-dualistic mindset that the world can't put into the basket of their assumptions. So the goddess comes up and says, I'll help you, don't worry. I'll help you differentiate. These are the good ones. Yeah, you can accept the good circumstances. That's what Jesus wants you. And he doesn't want you to accept the bad ones. You need to make progress, you know, towards this. This is the delusion. And ultimately, the fact is, because the goddess says, "No, I'm helping you out." And then she says, "Well, I'm co." Then she goes, "I'm co-saver, redemptress with Jesus." And then she'll ultimately find out that she wants to be the only one. She wants to replace Jesus. Her way, which is working on circumstances, which is working on this world, which is false duality, 100%. You see, the world, when you come into this world, the world wants you to be sane, okay? They want you to put you in the basket of sanity. And then they claim, well, if you're not sane, then you're going to be insane. And this is a totally false, dualistic context that this world demands of us. They leave out the third option. What is that? Truth. As Pilate said, well, what is truth? Truth, what is truth? Right. We're asked for an explanation. This is all wrong. Truth is not something that can be explained. Especially to dualism. Especially as a circumstance. When people talk about circumstance, explanation, they want to say, well, what? Explain the circumstances of truth. Give me the circumstances. In other words, give me some place, thing, something that can be searched and found. There are no circumstances or situations in truth, and therefore no circumstances or situations exist. Therefore, they cannot be searched for or found, right? So how can we give explanation based on explaining circumstances and situations? We can pragmatically talk about the intermediate step here, vision of oneness, etc. That's as far as we can go, really. So, the problem is when you come in this world in a state of truth, non-dual, the non-dual, they won't be able to put that in the basket of sanity. Okay, the world's not able to put that in the basket of sanity. So what do? They automatically then put it in the basket of insanity. And then get all concerned and worried about you and say, oh my gosh, you know, I there's something wrong with my child. You know, he's not entirely sane. I can't really say he's sane or she is sane. I can't say they are sane. I can't say my child is sane. So, doctor, what do I do? There must be some sort of insanity here. You see how wicked dualism is? How wicked it is. Do you see? You're hearing this. Are we hearing this is the question. All right, when you come into this world, appear to come into it. Everyone thinks you're coming into a set of circumstances. Everyone thinks you're coming into a world. You're not really coming into a world. You're appearing in a dream. And when you realize you're appearing in a dream, those who don't realize that they're in it's just a dream, they don't think you're sane. They can't fit you into those assumptions that they have. So they double down on the mistake of false assumptions. The corollary of false assumption is this duality of sanity and insanity. Of choosing, you know, circumstances. This makes me happy. This makes me sad. What if you're just blissful all the time? They say, that must be insane, because you're supposed to be happy with good circumstances and sad with bad circumstances, right? They think this is life. And again, there is no life. There's no life in a dream. It's not life. It's a dream. It's a scam dream. What we are is eternal life, that is spirit, which is perfectly free. No circumstances or situations. There's just the flow of experiencing. That's it. But never do you ever come across a circumstance or situation. So McCartney's singing, with a little luck, we can work it out. We can make this whole darn thing work out. So he's an optimist. He goes, hey, we can work on the world. We can make better circumstances. Come on, you know. And so everyone in the world is struggling. We want good circumstances. We got good situations. But really, what we really want is the bliss of reality, of what we are, which is not experiencing any circumstances at all, or situations. Which is bliss. It doesn't change. No matter what happens in the world, it doesn't have any effect on it at all. So, this is when we talk about truth, this is a different category. So don't try to apply it, you know, to the United Nations and climate change and all this stuff. Just let that be what it is, okay? Or if you're against it, just let that be what it is. That's fine. Either way, it's fine, okay? Don't struggle with the categories of sanity and insanity. Just let them be whatever it is you think is sane and whatever you think is insane. Just let that be what it is. But the third category is your interest in what we're saying here in truth. Your interest in it and your familiarity. Just let that be what it is. Because again, truth is not based on anything. So it just is. So when we give up this, when we are willing to say, I can be neutral about sanity or insanity, about circumstance or situation, it's okay, I'm not trying to base my happiness on it, then we're able to feel what is already present as truth, as always present, which is not subject to any situation or circumstance whatsoever. And our feeling, experiencing, and then becomes based on that, you see. That's what is. We say based on it, but it's more just what is. It's not really based on anything. It's just the isness of what is. So words can be tricky, but if we just realize that this is the third category we're talking about here, don't bring the other two into play. Don't bring them into play. Don't need to educate them. It's not an educational situation in that way at all. It's a hearing and a listening and a hearing and a wow situation. So again, 50th anniversary, October 21st. Big deal for me. Now, I don't know if I'm going to do, maybe I'll do some graphics and put some up, but I find it's very confining trying to do graphics. I feel I'm really much confined because it's so difficult to do it. It really is. To put it together, to find a way to make it all seem, you know, it's for me, it's my computer's so slow. It's old. It's very slow. Very little memory. Even the programs I'm using, you know, everything conspires to make it, and just inherently trying to do it that way. I find this taping like this is way more liberating and freeing and expressive, and boom, 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 boom. We can just go like that. I can shift gears at the moment, you know, whereas you have a narrative in a graphic program, in a slideshow, it seems set in stone once you put the slide in. Whereas here I can just shift gears, you know, any time when inspiration hits, I can say, wait a minute, let me just shift gears over here. It's way more expressive of the flow that is. And you can practice. I'm neither sane nor am I not sane. I'm neither insane nor am I not insane. I'm neither sane nor insane. I am is neither sane nor insane. Okay? I am is neither sane nor insane. I am is neither sane nor insane. So the patience is letting it sit there and not try to stuff it into the basket of insanity or sanity. To keep it in the basket of wow. This is the key, such a big key, such a huge key. If you don't have this one, the struggles will continue. You keep trying to stuff it into some basket and figure it out, and it just isn't going to work that way. So just let it, put it in the basket of wow. How about that? The basket of wow. Now I want Jesus to celebrate the 50th. I mean, I want him, you know, come, like, hey, there's an invitation. Let's have a party. I mean, this is a big deal for me. I mean, I don't know. Think of anyone. I don't know if anyone else in the world is even aware of this. But holy cow. We're talking about, you know, maybe people will be offended. You say it's the best. Or, well, let's put it this way. It's certainly unsurpassed, all right? If someone else wants to put something else up there and say, this is really wonderful, you, fine, I have no problem with that. Go ahead if that's what you, how you feel about it and that's what you're getting out of it, absolutely. But I'll say this, A Course in Miracles and its extension of Journey Beyond Words and the Other Voice, this is unsurpassed. It's unsurpassed. It's right at the top. It's unsurpassed in terms of helpfulness for us. So if we don't celebrate that, you know, what do we celebrate then? What are we celebrating, really? If we just let that go, you know, no big deal. I mean, well, then what is a big deal? This is a huge deal, and I'm afraid the world will just let it go by without even a mention. So I'm mentioning it here, at least Jesus, I'm mentioning it here. Thank you, on behalf of everyone, every dreamer. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I'm speaking because they cannot, they're too afraid to express their thanks, so I'll express it to you on behalf of everyone. How about that? Because I know that if the continuity fear wasn't so severe, everyone would be thanking Jesus. They make a big deal out of it. It's the continuity fear that prevents it. It's the attempt to appear to be sane that prevents it. You know, instead, just be in the wow. Okay? Truth is not based on anything. It's not even based on sanity. Okay? You got this, is very important. It's not based on good circumstances or situations or even sanity. Truth is, that's it. Truth is. So, I, on behalf of everyone, all dreamers, I will express the utmost gratitude to Jesus on the 50th for what he did for us, for himself too. I mean, because we're all one. He did it for us because we weren't able to do it yet. We just express which was to clarify for us. And encourage and clarify. That's a big responsibility and undertaking, and without, you know, much feedback initially, it's pretty extraordinary to, you know, just have that long-term outlook and see, you know, it's only continuity fear that's causing all the trouble, all our delaying and that. So he forgives all of that for, and everyone. There's no worries. I know that's all it is. That when you return to the truth and the continuity fear evaporates, then you'll say, ah, how wonderful, you know. It's all good at that point. As Ram Maharshi said, it all ends out perfect. It all turns out perfect in the end, you see. This is attitude too. He saw that. So, you know, I'll do what I can do. on behalf of everyone. You know, this situation is super rare in this world, like A Course in Miracles coming into the world. That is, you know, extraordinarily rare. A super, super, super blessing. And to just not even mark the 50th anniversary of that. I mean, people mark the wedding anniversary, the 50th golden wedding anniversary. I mean, this is a big, big deal. They throw a big party. They invite their friends, their gifts. I mean, this is, well, this is like, you know, infinitely more important. But it's likely to just slip by. But not here. The Holy Spirit made sure I caught it. How I caught it was, this is how I caught this, it's interesting. I wanted to find the song that was number one. I started looking, what's the number one song at certain dates, when I, like the one in summer of 78, when I started A Course in Miracles, when A Course in Miracles first published, which was June of 1976. What was the number one song then? So I went to Billboard and I looked that up. And then I said, well, I was looking up the publishing date of when was Of Course Miracles published. So in doing that, I came across the timeline of the publishing. I went back and it did say that, you know, the date that Helen Schuckman first heard the voice, October 21st. So that's how I actually came across this. Then I said, well, wait a minute. Wow. That sounds like important. Let me then. It's 50 years, isn't it? Indeed, it is. 50 years. So that's how I came across this. It's pretty amazing. And the songs were not. Well, the song that was number one when. In October 21st, 1965, was Yesterday by the Beatles. It was number one for a long time, maybe a couple months or so. I mean, I think that song's been covered more than any other song in history. Pretty interesting, isn't it? That A Course in Miracles would begin, and the number one song was Yesterday, which has been covered by more than anyone else, out of any other song. By musicians singing it, you hear that, you've heard it just everywhere. How many weddings have had that? How many occasions? It's a standard. It's like one of the gold standards as far as song goes. Maybe the top one as far as people playing it. Yesterday, you know, I can't say it now. My voice is, and then of course, A Miracle begins at that very date. That's pretty doggone interesting. Haven't eaten anything. What time is it? Yeah, 1 o'clock. That's okay. I don't really feel like eating so much anymore. Eating is interesting, and you can get into this conscious world. Something's more important than eating, really. It's not that important. This 50th anniversary, this Jubilee, is very important. Now, what happened in Bible Jubilee, Jews? Well, all debts are forgiven. All debts are forgiven. The land lays fallow. People take a year off. I mean, all debts are forgiven. I mean, it's a big deal. It's a big deal. Prisoners are released. All prisoners are released. All debts are forgiven. You know, I mean, this is there's a lot of sanity. You know, there. I mean, well, I shouldn't use that term based on what we've said. There's a lot of pragmatism to some of the Jewish law, you know. I mean, some of the ancient law. We should have something like that. I think the world is missing the boat in so many ways. You should wipe the slate clean. Forgiveness is a year of forgiveness, is what it really is. The Jubilee, the 50th, is a year of forgiveness. You forgive yourself, you forgive others, you forgive the debts, you forgive the crimes, you forgive and say, hey, let's all of us together start fresh. Okay. and get right with God. In other words, so there's, how cool would that be? You know, but we're in this monster situation now, actually. Of trying to obtain outcomes. But they said, well, to heck with outcomes for 1 year. Here, let's drop our obsession with outcomes here. Maybe Jesus will help us do that. Drop our obsession with outcomes in this coming year, starting October 21st. Stop our obsession with searching for circumstances and situations, which really means outcomes. This whole universe seems like constantly generating outcomes, right? Circumstances, situations, outcomes. The ant is walking along there is in a circumstance, a situation. We're looking for outcomes, good outcomes, trying to avoid bad outcomes, believing that how we feel and what our identity is based on this effort. Now, from an agricultural society, the ancient Jews, of course, everyone was agricultural back then, pretty much, right? So, I mean, from that standpoint, it's pragmatic because they were into crop rotation, they were into letting the fields recover. It was very important. This was just coming from the Elohim, or the ones who gave you this instruction of civilization to so-called humans. Is pragmatic in terms of agriculture. Don't use the same crop in the same field for too long. Don't let the soil regenerate. Every 7 years they allowed it to regenerate. They'd rotate and leave a plot of land. They'd have the land, they have different stuff planted, then they'd leave one section of it fallow. And the next year they just leave another section of fallow. So every 7 years each part of a plot of land would have a 7 year cycle, every part of their land. But there'd always be some of the land under cultivation and then some would be fallow. So continually their land would be regenerated like this. But on the 50th year, everything supposedly, I don't know if they grew crops then, but it was, you really let the whole nation go fallow and regenerate. You'd let go of outcomes for a while. So agriculturally, that's very wise tactic. Now we can extrapolate upon that some sort of spiritual meaning. Maybe it was there, maybe it's not there at all, but we don't need to extrapolate it. We can certainly see directly now the importance of for us to have this third category, the wow, the fallow, the neutral, just the wow. It's neither sanity nor insanity, actually. And spend some time just allowing that basket to be filled instead of trying to fill the other baskets with outcomes. Obviously, we need to, this world, keep functioning in some way, money, etc. But our consciousness can be in this wow place. So maybe Jesus will provide the wow for that Jubilee year. It's a Jubilee year. Look at it that way. Maybe Jesus will provide the wow that we need. And we, of course, we don't try to put it into whoops pulled on the cord, didn't I? Internet. Well, there's a fallow thing right there. There you go. The video just went fallow. The video just went fallow. Perfect. Perfect. That was just a wow. We look upwards, you know. We look upwards, right? It's not based on it's not based on sanity, nor is it based on insanity, actually. And we can get to this. I know it sounds like, whoa, what? I know we've been going towards sanity, of course. But ultimately, that becomes a barrier for us. Cool, cloudy day here in California, Bay Area. Still very nice. Still very gentle, but the weather here always seems to be like a blessing upon us. It never seems harsh. But then again, that too is a circumstance, isn't it? So what we're after is the wow. Not so much the weather, but the wow, okay? Not good weather, not bad weather, but the wow. Maybe Jesus will supply the wow. And maybe Jesus and friends will supply the wow. Maybe Jesus and friends will supply the wow for the world, for this Jubilee. We can look at this as a 1 year Jubilee, October 21st, 2015, October 21st, 2016, is a Jubilee time where we spend time every day, you know, spend time in the wow. Give a little time to not searching for outcomes. Not trying to force outcomes one way or the other. Not trying to work on sanity or insanity. But instead recognizing a third option here. So Jesus may do something. I certainly want him to. It's my overall quote-unquote circumstances, such be as it may, you can talk about it in those terms for a moment, you know, requires something to happen. Out of the ordinary, no question. The ordinary isn't working enough here. So something has to happen out of the ordinary. Out of what we would say the polarity of sanity and insanity, good, bad. It has to be out of that polarity. If something has to happen that doesn't fit in either one of those categories, because that's not, the good and the bad is not working for me anymore. It's not effective. So something extraordinary, some third category has to happen. The term 44, the number 44, I realized, I think yesterday, it means all for something. Someone who's all for. If you see someone wearing 44 in a dream or in the world, it seems to symbolize something. You're all for something. All fours, four, four, all fours. I'm all for something. I saw Jesus wearing 44. I'm all for it. I'm all for, you know, salvation. I'm all for it. 44th president would be all for what he's focused on, which is whatever it is, right? I mean, this planet and circumstances and outcomes, he's all for outcomes, you know, that path of time worship, he's all for it, which is true, right? But Jesus is all for So 44 can be, it means different things depending who's wearing it, who's, you know, where the symbol is. It means that they're all for something. They're all for something. Some focus, they're all for it. So we need something that's simply in a different category. We need something to take place that's just that we decide we're not going to put it in the normal categories at all. We're going to look at it and put it in a third category, the wow category, and just leave it there. Just leave it there. So we're not going to struggle with it. We're just going to, our struggle is just the wow, is just allowing the wow and experiencing the wow. That's the only struggle there'll be with it. It will not be a verbal struggle. It will not be a discussional struggle. It will not be an intellectual struggle. It will not be that sort of struggle here. It'll simply be a wow struggle. And I have found time and time again, when I go back to the wow, this is when the progress happens. When I stay in the intellectual, conceptual, mental, verbal, whatever struggle, right and wrong, good and bad, sane and insane, all this dualistic struggle, I just flounder and flounder and flounder. I might slam into some things, bouncing off this, that. No, it's just floundering. It's just floundering. And we don't want to try and, you know, do an elegant floundering. You know, this is folly. So, our path is the wow. As I said, we're walking together in the wow here. We'll get a wow. We'll get a wow. You know, this content here is very wowistic, no question about it. But this leads to greater wow. You know, this is how I see it. Dreaming, for instance, of Ananda Mahima, that's a big wow. Very big wow. Because she's in a third category. Okay, Ananda Mahima is definitely in a this wow category. It's not in the category of either sanity or nor insanity, but the wow category, entirely in the wow category. So dreaming of that, you know, is an intense wow. And this is how I took it. You cannot explain. You know, if you try to go into explanation, you're going to flounder. Don't need to go there. Don't need to go there. That's all the land of scam. The land of scam. We live in the land of scam. We leave the land of scam when we are willing to dwell in the land of wow. I'm a citizen of wow. I dwell in the land of wow. I don't dwell in the land of scam. Is this world, this universe? I don't even talk about that really. I don't see it in terms of universe and world at all. I see it as the land of scam. The realm of scam, the land of scam. You want to scram from the land of scam. And the way to scram from it is into the land of wow. So you can converse, like, for instance, with Ananda Mahima or Mama Harshi, or you can hang out with them, converse, whatever you experience. But you don't try to put it into the duality. You just ultimately, it's just the wow you're experiencing. That's what's important. Yeah, there's this talk and stuff, you know, that can just be on the periphery there. It's fine, but at the center is the wow. As you just say, wow, this is neither nor. It isn't either nor, isn't it? It's neither sanity nor is it insanity. So it must be there's a third category here that isn't based on anything. It's not based on any circumstance or situation. And this is a huge wow for us, huge wow. We're waking up. It's profound. So we don't need to worry, you know, like, well, I need to understand and explain and on to my Ron Maharshi or Jesus or Longchenpa. I need to. No, we don't. This is not the purpose of it, really. Again, there are a few that are keyed into expressing in a certain, like, for instance, that's what I'm doing. But I'm really emphasizing the wow. This is what I'm saying is the key for everybody, for me too. But somebody has to bring this up and talk about it and clarify it. Otherwise, we'll likely, you know, keep floundering and floundering and floundering and not really understand why. And then come up with some cockamamie religion or something based on our assumptions, false assumptions, and say, well, let's call it good, you know. I mean, this is as good as we can do. And so many have done that. Now, the question of enlightenment, is it sudden or gradual? Well, it's all at once. But here's the thing. All at once is neither sudden nor is it not sudden. It's everything all at once. It's all at once. So I can relate to them them saying, well, sudden, it's sudden. But that, again, that can be very misleading, too, to use the term sudden. Sudden to what? If it all goes all at once, where who's experiencing the suddenness? Where's the suddenness? It's actually totally gentle. It's imperceptible, virtually. I mean, so the connotation like this, kaboom, you know. No, there's no kaboom, because the kaboom also goes. It's also gone. That also goes at the same time. It's all of it goes all at once. The whole delusion, it all goes at the same moment. It all goes at once. So there's no kaboom. There's no kaboom. There's no suddenness to the suddenness, as you might look at it that way. It's neither sudden nor is it not sudden, or it's both sudden and not sudden. Neither is a better way to put it. It's neither not sudden nor is it not sudden. It's neither sudden nor is it not sudden. It's neither sudden nor is it not sudden. Look at it that way. Because we need to use a term to refer to it, but then we need to practice, make sure that we don't put this term into the basket of sanity or insanity, because it all goes at once, including the suddenness. That's why the experience I've had of going into abidance, it's been so smooth, it's seamlessly smooth, seamless. It's a seamless shift, and there it is. You say, wait a minute, where's all the suddenness? Where's the kaboom? There's no kaboom. So it both is and it isn't sudden. It both is and is not sudden. Or it's neither is nor is not sudden. Neither is nor is not sudden. It's all at once. And it's also neither. Either is nor is not all at once. So in other words, we keep practicing not putting some explanation into the basket of sanity or insanity, our outcome. All outcomes go at once. See, what are we letting go of? Outcomes. So we drop all outcomes all at once. This is enlightenment. This is abidance. So if you're dropping all outcomes, then we're also dropping this outcome of suddenness too, aren't we? Seeing suddenness as some sort of outcome, that too goes, all right? That too goes at the same moment as all other outcomes. All outcomes go in as one grouping of outcomes, you know. The group of outcomes that's all set down all at once. Has to be. Otherwise, there's no sitting down at all. We're just choosing some other outcome. We're just looking at it as, oh, I got an outcome of enlightenment. I got this outcome of this. I got an outcome of suddenness. That's not it, is it? That's not enlightenment. So I'm on fire because this is the time to be on fire. If we're not on fire now, well, we need to be. We need to be. It's a great time to be on fire. This is the crucial moment. This meeting and bond, really. This is the crucial one. This is slipping under the radar. The Holy Spirit knew all about it, though. Because ultimately, they're really settling right now on the parameters of what they'll agree to in Paris. So Paris is more of a show, dog and pony show kind of thing. It's a big show. It's a big showcasing, okay, of what they've already agreed upon, really. Now, there may be wrangling and disputes and pressures and all, but ultimately, we're trying to get the agreement right now in Bonn. Well, actually, starting on the 19th, tomorrow. They expect to. So Paris is a big show. It's a big putting on a big. It's a big production, a big show to the world, saying, "Look, we did it. You know, we did something." I don't know how it's going to go. A lot of people are pessimistic. Some are not so pessimistic. But the bottom line is this: Bonn conference on climate change, UN Forum conference on climate change in Bonn, Germany, starting tomorrow, the 19th, going to the 23rd. This is the real important one. And we got it in our sights. We know this did not slip by, thanks to the Holy Spirit. And, you know, thanks to all of you helping out too. I mean, the Holy Spirit works through all of us. Help cluing us all in. We've gotten clued into this now. So we need to be on fire right now. Right now. Don't get blinded by Paris, right? Don't get blinded by Paris. That's just a big show. We need to be on fire right now. And Jesus, that is the Jubilee, is the 21st, right in the middle of the Bonn conference. That's no coincidence. That's no coincidence whatsoever. Now, I believe we can work with Jesus. I believe we can host Jesus at this point. Absolutely. Absolutely. We have seen enough and enough discipline of the wow, and you know, just like I said, it's all at once, but it's neither all at once nor is it not all at once. It neither is nor is not all at once, meaning it's not all at once is not some outcome we're trying to reach. All outcomes are set down simultaneously, all at once, simultaneously, have to be. You know, just the fact that we're easily looking at this and feeling the wow of it and not trying to put it, you know. Why will we not be able to entertain Jesus? Why will we not be able to? is see, the people are afraid because they think he's all about outcomes. No, he's all about no outcomes. So we're fine. You know, we're fine. It's the ones who think about it's about outcomes that are freaking out right now. When's Jesus coming? When's the rapture coming? When's it? Oh my gosh, are we ready? Oh, I gotta nail the. I gotta have the date. I gotta make sure. You're not sure the outcome. They're missing it. They're missing it. They're missing it. It's all about no outcomes. And so, since we're focused on that, we're fine. We're fine. Why should we be worried? We'd only be worried if we have a false assumption, since nobody can figure out what outcomes Jesus wants because they have the false assumption that he's really about outcomes. That just the outcomes are mysterious. We cannot figure it out. They're all nervous. They say, well, we're not ready, we're not ready, we're not ready. And they always push it down the road. They've been pushing this down the road for 2,000 years. Not ready yet, Jesus. They've been expecting Jesus for 2,000 years to return. I mean, the apostles all expected Jesus to return in their lifetimes. But what do? They pushed it down the road. And we've been pushing it down the road for 2,000 years. It's time to stop pushing it down the road. All right, this Jubilee, it's time to say no more pushing down the road. Okay, let's have the presence of clarity, of no outcomes here. Except, of course, the intermediate step, which is the outcome that frees us from the whole notion of any outcome whatsoever, based on our continuity fear, the necessity, pragmatic necessity, of not leaping back into pure knowingness. First, we perceive something that represents no outcome. Okay, this is we perceive that which represents to us perceptually, symbolically, no outcome. Okay? And then from there, it's easy then to be in the knowingness, simply in the knowingness, which is inherently free of any even consideration or notion of either outcome or no outcome. It's not based on anything at all. It's just pure, it just is, the knowingness just is. So first we get a vision of, that symbolizes no outcome to us. Vision of Christ, vision of oneness, death-free realm. These are various ways of referring to it. Abidance in the now. Abidance in the now. Okay, what is the now? Well, it's that symbolizes no outcome, doesn't it? Symbolizes no outcome. So the vision that symbolizes no outcome to us. This is what we can do here in this world. We can absolutely do that here. And should we move on from this world, we can also do it in the death-free realm too. Absolutely. There is such a realm. I've visited it. I've experienced it. And you feel no outcome here, because everything there has been there from the very beginning and will be there till the very end, so to speak, indefinitely, without any true alteration of its potential nature whatsoever. So you just say, wow, there's no outcomes here. Now, close, in crude terms, I've said before, one way of getting a faint echo of this is really beautiful golf courses that are manicured and maintenance like crazy. And you go out there and you look and you say, you look and say, whoa, it seems like this place is sort of free of outcomes, like it's always this way. And they try to keep it that way. And, you know, the leaves are all picked up, and every trees and bushes, everything's pruned, and the grass is mowed perfectly, and everything's watered perfectly, and you just like, you say, wow, is this place free of outcomes, or what? What is this? So you get this faint, there's a memory that sort of gets triggered of, hey, I like no outcomes. I like no outcomes. I experienced this. I left one hole and went to the tee, and it was so beautiful. The whole area, I said, I don't want anything to change. I don't want to move from here. I just want to just stay here forever. I just like this feeling I'm getting of no outcomes. I'm getting this very strong feeling. I say, why do I need to do anything? I don't feel like I want to do anything. Let me just remain here and do nothing. And just soak in this feeling of no outcomes. Very memorable. And again, I said the story, we went out on Christmas Day on a golf course that had been reseeded with rye, and we were like one of the first people out on the course that had been reopened, and they of course had immaculately manicured everything for the opening, and it was just like, It was such a shocking experience to be in this world and yet having experience where it seems like everything is free of outcomes. Or you're in some different dimension where there's no outcomes here. Everything's perfect. The grass is perfect. Speaking of that, I just had a dream. I remember I had a dream. It was the last night or night before where, oh yeah, wow. I look at this lawn, this big lawn, and the part closest to me, I saw it was normal, like a normal lawn, you know, it's kind of ratty, some parts are nice, it's uneven, you see a lot of outcomes happening in that lawn, right? Some good, some bad, etc. And then it just smoothly transitioned, quickly transitioned, but There was seemingly sort of a soft line of transition, you might say that. It was both abrupt, but not too abrupt, I would say, into this perfect lawn, all of equal height, of the most intense green and bluish-green tones. They call it bluegrass, I guess, Kentucky bluegrass. All of uniform height, all of this just gorgeous, gorgeous, gorgeous lawn where you didn't see any outcome but perfection there. You know, and since it was all perfect, you don't even see it as an outcome. Outcomes positing positive and negative, right? A dualistic, very dualistic term, outcome. Yeah, and I experienced that. I just said, wow. Then I had a lawnmower, and I said, well, I'm just here to cut the grass. Maybe to keep up appearances or something. I don't know. Maybe I just decide not to cut it. But there you go. There's a dream that shows this no outcomeness. So golf is just an excuse to get out on these courses where it feels like everything is just right and you don't need to change anything. You don't need any outcomes. And it sort of feels like you're free of any outcomes. Of course, you keep up the semblance of outcomes by hitting your golf ball. There you have good and bad outcomes, mostly bad. But, you know, maybe 50-50, kind of. I mean, it's always in flux. So you keep up the pretense of outcomes, but also you're kind of looking around and saying, wow. That tree, it feels like that tree's always been there. That tree's perfect. I just want it to be just like that. I want this scenery to be just like this. I don't need it to change. So you're freed up from the idea, like, I need to pursue outcomes, you know. It's like a house. Imagine if you're in a house where everything was just, you say, you know what? I don't want to change a thing. I don't feel like I need to change anything here. And I can just, I feel like I feel this way forever. You know, it's just perfect the way it is. Which is pretty cool, right? I don't have to redecorate it or remodel or do anything. Just let it be. Just let it be the way it is. Now, when you get into this mode, this is a very spiritual mode. I get into this mode in, we can get in this mode anywhere, actually. But I don't want to contradict what I said earlier about places. But this is on a slightly different level. We're talking about a slightly different area here of triggering echoes of no outcomeness. Some places seem to trigger it more than others. For it's different for each one of us. But usually where we are, we want to change things. We get used to it. Nah, you know. So if we go on vacation, people tend to want to go on vacation somewhere and they say, hey, you know what? I'm free of pursuing outcomes, and it's just wonderful. Oh, look at this beautiful house. Some people like go to Carmel or something and go along the coast and look at all these cottages along was it Sir Francis Drake? Highway 1 or something goes along, right along the scenic outlook road or something, right along the coast from Ocean Beach, Carmel, along down to Point Lobos or something near there. And all these beautiful homes and cottages, and it just like you just feel like, wow, this is so cool. I just want to enjoy this. I don't want to think about, oh, well, I would paint the house a different color. I'd do a different trim on this, or the roof isn't quite the way I want it, or the yard. No, you just let it be because it's not my problem. You know, it's not my house. It's not. I don't have to worry about that. Whereas if you go to your house and stuff, oh, the pine needles, I got to pick those up. You know, the debris on the driveway, got to take care of the car. We're burdened with all these outcomes we got to pursue. But if we're on vacation, we say, I don't have to worry about any of that. So just let it be, just let it be, just let it be. You don't have to pursue outcomes. So this is why vacations tend to refresh us, spiritually refresh us. Which is, I need a permanent vacation that way, actually. But it's a short one somewhere would be nice. It's been a long, long time, and I've been burdened by so many pressures of outcomes constantly, as we all are. Get out on a golf course in a beautiful place and just forget about the world, forget about outcomes, but you stay pragmatically in touch with them by your golf game. But even that, you say, you know, what the heck, bogey, you know, whatever. You say, I missed that one. Oh, well, go to the next tee. Hey, look at this beautiful hole, you know. Am I going to hit a good shot or not? I don't really care. Wherever I hit it, it's going to be beautiful, so let me just hit it. I have to remember that, is just hit the ball. And not too hard, hurt my back trying to hit it too hard. Just nice, easy swing, just hit it, and then go. hit it and go, and just enjoy the surroundings. Keep it in the wow basket, you know. Keep it in the wow. There's a wow. And go to a restaurant, you know, you're so happy, you don't care, the food, that's all good, everything's all good, the scenery, it's all good, it's all good. I don't have to worry about outcomes right now, it's all good. And this is what we see as heaven, right, a place where we don't have to worry about outcomes, right? We're not chasing outcomes. This is heaven, this is the kingdom of heaven, no question about it. And Jesus says we can even experience this here in this world. Theoretically, of course, we can. Pragmatically, it's a little more difficult. Because you may be in the flow, but other people may not. Say, hey, you need to do this, you need to do this. Hey, take care of this, take care of this. Everything's disintegrating, getting dirty. You know, wash the car, you know. It never ends, does it? The demands never end. If you're a householder, demands never end. Which is why often, you know, the people drop out of householder life and doing meditation where there's no demand for outcomes. But sure, householder, they have to work at the spiritual path. They have to be way more disciplined, very disciplined. Otherwise, you'll get overwhelmed by the demand for outcomes. Especially in like California, where the houses, the way we build them, you know, it's ridiculous. It has to do with earthquakes and various things, but they always have to upgrade it. I mean, they build a fence, and everything you build here, you know, in 30, 40 years, you have to redo. Everything. It's crazy. Totally crazy place. Europe, you know, a lot smarter that way. They build the buildings, and it's going to last a couple, you know, a couple thousand years. Make it of stone. Fortunately, they don't have earthquakes there. Build the wall, build it of stone, so we don't have to do anything to it for the next 500,000 years. Don't have to worry. So, you know, they're able to get their attention off of outcomes to some extent. But no way in California, that they're just a constant frantic. I mean, right now, for instance, everybody's frantically worried about their roofs. I talked to the roofing people company, and they say we're completely slammed. We can't keep up with it. The roofers, everybody's just utterly slammed because people are freaking out about El Nino, and they need their roofs redone or fixed, or, you know, just so roofers, they're completely booked, and they can't keep up. Because why? The roofs give out. The number one trash in this area is roofs, tearing roofs off. People are always tearing roofs. It's a big business here. Back up the big truck to a roof, get people on the roof, they tear off the whole roof, they put a new roof on all the time. Crazy. Like in Europe, you get a good slate roof or something, you know, let it last for thousands of years. There has to be some minor repairs, of course, but just the style of building in Europe, compared to California, is just night and day. It's nuts here, absolutely nuts. Nothing is permanent. You know, we think redwood, oh, I'll build a redwood fence. Wow, yeah, well, guess what? 100 years from now, you're gonna have to, or less than that, you're gonna have to replace it. Redwood fences, how long do they last? Now, I mean, now they last a lot less because it's all sapwood, actually. You can't get good redwood anymore. It's all, you know, short-term growth redwood trees. There's no more old growth being cut, as far as I know. And if there's some, whatever it is, it's going over to China or Japan for, you know, exotic, special stuff. Expensive, really expensive. But fencing, sapwood. Of course, they use pressure treated for the posts. They used to use just straight redwood, actually. But overall, anything in redwood now, it's going to rot and decay because it's all sapwood. No, hardly any grain to it, just sapwood. So it's not going to last. It's not going to last. What we're building, everything is flimsy. It's not going to last. It's tough to have clarity in a culture like this. Very difficult. Of course, in a culture like Europe, it's also tough because they get lazy. They say, oh, we've got plenty of time. And they don't push for it. Whereas here, you say, well, if I'm not disciplined and push for it, I'm going to get nothing. I'm going to be totally inundated, snowed under by outcomes. So I better be very vigilant and work really hard at it. Whereas in Europe, you know, other places in the world, you say, you know, maybe tomorrow. Tomorrow will be a good opportunity too. I won't have much to do. You end up at cafes, you know, drinking coffee. And I mean, it's very tempting, right? I mean, that lifestyle. Yeah, I could just hang out, have some pastries, drink espresso, watch the world go by, and it's just like, wow, this is like, I'm enjoying this. No outcomes, not worrying about outcomes. But that doesn't quite have the escape velocity. And you get into then philosophies instead of truth. So Europe is full of philosophers. Rome, you know, Greece was full of philosophers, etc. Only problem with Greece and the Asia Minor, so they had earthquakes, and so they'd build stone, everything in stone to last thousands of years, and then an earthquake would come and it all come crashing down. Happened a lot. Pergamon, a lot of those cities of Asia Minor were extraordinary buildings, and yet they were destroyed. And now you look and there's nothing but ruins. Sardis and Ephesus, you name it, it's an earthquake zone. That was their tormentor, but ultimately it helped them, you know, it helped them be more disciplined and say, hey, we can't be so indolent. You can't wander under the palm trees indefinitely. I mean, it's easy to get lazy, but flip side here, it's easy to be too burdened. Half, six of one, half a dozen of another. People in this society, they dream for an indolent society. The people in indolent societies dream of an active society. Grass is always greener. Either way, you have to be disciplined. Nowadays, in the coming days, you know, this society here in the United States is dreaming of being indolent. So they'll get up in the morning, they'll smoke pot, okay? So then they'll go to a cafe, maybe an outdoor cafe, nice street, watch the world flow by. They'll drink their espresso, and they'll eat nice, you know, pastries. And sit there and watch the world go by. Absolutely. This is where the culture, some of it, is heading. They'll say, well, I'm helping the, you know, climate change. I think this is where the whole planet is going, actually. And they will develop all these philosophies, and they'll call it, you know, spiritual. They're already doing it like crazy. There's so much spiritual philosophy around. It's all dualistic. Even the non-dual is dualistic, except for the really top teachers. You know, even that, I find, is a little lazy, really, compared to the, you know, the great standard bearers that we have. I mean, yeah, it could be better. This is where we're going. We're going to a drug society. I mean, it's very tempting. It's very tempting. You have to be very disciplined to avoid this. Very disciplined. It's not just pot, it's all drugs, actually. But drugs are going to be legalized. Why? They want an indolent society. We don't want an industrialized... I mean, the goal of the United Nations is to de-industrialize the world, ultimately. And, you know, like I said, I'm not either for it or against it. You know, they're going to do what they're going to do. The scientists and the social planners, etc., are working on this. They know their business, okay? So they know their business. We have to be aware of the unintended consequences of this spiritually, though. And that is an indolent society. A society that will be using a lot of drugs, a lot of drugs. In fact, everybody will be on some sort of drug, actually. The drugs will be designed to make us indolent and want to sit and, you know, and the greatest drug of all is caffeine, actually. Strong espresso or caffeine. Unfortunately, a lot of people are getting caffeine intolerance and problems now. I certainly did. I've been through that. French press coffee. Very strong coffee. I went through a phase. And ultimately, my whole digestive system, the whole movement of food through my digestive system completely stopped. Nothing moved through me anymore. The caffeine has a very severe side effects on a lot of people, but they'll have drugs for that too, you know. But everyone is going to, the goal again is Boulevardiers on the Champs-Élysées, you know. It's interesting, the climate change is in Paris, which is the home of Boulevardiers. Sitting at a cafe, watching the cars go by, let's all just chill, let's all just cool out. And they'll have a whole philosophy, they'll call it spiritual religion, of this. And this will deindustrialize, this will lower the carbon emissions of the world. You know, we'll not really be going anywhere, we'll go from our flat to the cafe and hang out. If we go on a vacation, we might take a electric train or something. And so our lives will be like this. They're going to drug everybody, okay? No question about it. And the thing is, caffeine makes it all interesting. See, this is why caffeine is so important right now. This is why Starbucks is all around the world. I don't want to, let me not single out them. There's a lot of coffee shops from a lot of different companies. It's the world mania, is caffeine. It's absolute global mania, because this is key to the whole thing. Now, we might think that, well, what does caffeine do? It makes us more industrious, right? Not necessarily. It can also make, just sitting there, talking and observing, it can make that more interesting too. And they're also trying to channel our endeavor into eroticism. And everybody will be, you know, on birth control, so you know, births will be way down. And so there's an activity they feel that people want to just engage in, a way to pass the time also. Constant sex with all sorts of different partners, you know, genders, both genders, different partners, everything. This is a way to just keep our, like, oh, this is fun, we enjoy this, we don't have to be going out working, we don't have to be industrious. So the caffeine helps with that. It's an aphrodisiac. Very much so. So they'll have all these aphrodisiacs, they'll have all these enhancers like DMT, ecstasy, all this stuff, pot, hashish, cocaine, whatever. Heroin is making a huge comeback in the world now. They'll have opiates too, and this will all be part of the global agenda, actually. So you just feel like just sitting here and just saying, wow, you know, not wow, you're just like, ugh. It's not the true wow here. See, true spiritual path is also extreme low carbon emissions, okay? Very healthy for the planet, true spiritual path. But there's no drugs involved at all here. No sex, no drugs, no rock and roll at all. Because that doesn't, doing that is just time worshiping without being industrious about it. So this is the UN's goal. This is the end game that they want. Which is why I said there are these three phases that I saw in a dream of severe distraction problems. And I likened it to the cocaine epidemic in the 1920s, the 1970s, 80s, and then this next epidemic is a drug epidemic, is going to come now. I mean, they're around the world, they're pushing to legalize drugs, as many as possible. And there is this overall agenda. This is not what I'm seeing. The end game is to keep us all happily drugged, okay? And I know there's some of you that can resonate with this and say, yeah, I can see this too, right? And playing video games too. Playing video games. You don't need to go out and do anything. You just play video games. And we'll be sitting there texting people, you know, sitting in the cafe on all these drugs, texting. So they don't want us being industrious or doing anything. Well, okay. Six of one, half a dozen other. But certainly, if they want to save the planet, you know, this is a strategy, right? It's not the only strategy, of course. Spiritual path is also a strategy. The problem is their strategy interferes with the spiritual path. Now, pragmatically, they would say, well, nobody's interested in the spiritual path. And, you know, they have a plausible point there. It's not something that, you know, I'm going to argue with. But you could also say that this is by design, too. You see, and they can't really argue with that either. So there's no point in getting an argument, you know. I mean, they're not willing to accept the fact that it's avoiding the spiritual path is also their design. So they're actually creating the problem that they claim now that they have to solve it in a certain way. But certainly, if everyone in the world really gets on the spiritual path, carbon's in the planet would be healed very quickly. Very quickly. And ultimately, we'd realize there isn't even a planet at all. And we wouldn't even choose to remain with this experiencing even. Well, actually, we have the vision of oneness that symbolizes no outcomes. And then we depart from this experiencing even that, you know. So they want to sustain the planet. See, you can't have your cake and eat it too. If you take the spiritual path, there's no reason to sustain the planet very long at all. So they want us to say, well, we got to hand this down to our, you know, continually hand it, sustain it, sustain it, sustain it, sustain it. Well, if everybody's enlightened, there's no need to sustain it. So there, you know, there's a conflict in their premises here. They say, no, we got to find a way to sustain the planet. So the only way to really sustain the planet, plus have it healthy, so that, as they say, is to drug everybody. That's what their aim is. There's no question about it. You just look at the attitudes of young people towards drugs, and you realize pretty soon these are the people, the voting blocks. These are the people who are going to be making all the decisions. And they're going to decide to legalize all drugs. Almost all of them. They say, yeah, and sex. Just complete immorality in terms of sex, sexual behavior, amorousness. They're just going to say anything goes. It's all good. It's all good. If it feels good, do it. That was just, of course, the 1960s motto of hippies. Just, if it feels good, it's good. And hippies were the prototype of the low-carbon people who, you know, hey, let's just hang out here stoned all day. But, of course, these people will think they're doing the right thing for the planet by doing this. And, of course, they're all be renters. They don't want to be householders. They just want to rent a little flat somewhere and go down, have a nice meal at the restaurant, and sit out and just, you know, watch the world go by, watch the sunset. Chat, text, Facebook, whatever, you know, yeah. Now, this can ultimately be turned to advantage, it could be, but it could also be, they could get, I mean, it's time worshiping. And they may just say, this is it. And the problem is, a great depression may set in. You know, it may have very unintended consequences, especially all the sex, the drugs, the rock and roll. This has unintended consequences. Things don't turn out the way they hope they may. And industriousness may, you know, make a big comeback at some point, right? Absolutely. So we do not want to get caught up in this trap of being a boulevardier, because it does seem, wow, this is really where it's at. But it's not really where it's at. And I believe this is a trap that Jesus and Holy Spirit are very much aware of. Just like in drug epidemics of the 20s, the 70s, 80s, there's another drug epidemic coming. This may be part, well, I'm sure it's part of the concern of the Holy Spirit. There's no question about that. A collapsing back into time worshiping of saying, you know, this is it. Let's take our soma and call it good. Like the Vedic times, you know, soma. I mean, they were worshippers of soma, time worshippers, and they said, but we're this is all we need. This is great. We've got it. We've got all the mantras for fixing things, and we know the truth. This is happiness. Of course, the soma plant, somehow they lost access to it somehow. I don't know how exactly that worked. Maybe climate change. But no, I mean, climate change is, you know, I'm not going to dispute this, you know, the overall findings. Certainly, there has been a raise of temperature of 0.85 degrees centigrade. There has been some. Now, there's always been fluctuation on this planet for a lot of reasons, but they, anthropogenic climate change, what they're talking about, is that the term? Anthropogenic, maybe. Human caused is that what they're all concerned about. Because after all, in the past, climate change did happen. Severe climate change actually happened. Severe. But it did result in wiping out, you know, species and extinctions of all sorts of stuff. You know, so what they're saying is, if we want to survive as humans on this planet, we got to be careful here, because we may very well be render us extinct. It's not going to render the planet extinct. You know, this is what they're saying. That's nonsense. Likely nonsense. I think they're overstating it there. The planet's going to be destroyed. You know, humans may be destroyed or marginalized or minimalized or something. But that's been going on throughout history. You know, there's, what, 5 major extinction level events and many sub events throughout history. And the Earth has changed and changed and changed and changed. There's been ice ages. There's been tropical times when the world was lots of inundated with low lake, you know, lakes and marshes everywhere, and tropical. And it just goes, it changes for a lot of different reasons. And, you know, we may not be able to stop the change. You know, maybe, you know, methane may be released, a lot of methane. There's a lot of things that can happen, actually. So that the methane traps are released, you know, that's curtains for us. It's unless we come with some technology. So yeah, a lot of things could happen, and they're just saying, well, we want to sustain the world forever. But ultimately, spiritually, that's not a goal at all. That's not, should not be a spiritual goal, because we have a capacity to symbolize no outcomes, freedom from outcomes, and project it upon the world. And once we do that spiritually, we don't need this fakery, this scam of a universe. When we say transcend, this is a very strange word to use. You know, they talk about transcendence. It's not really transcending. It's a matter of saying, well, we don't need to keep trying to scam God. That's not a transcendence. Say, we don't need to do this anymore. It doesn't work. I don't like it. It's not what I really want. It's unnecessary. So I just set it down. It's not really transcending. When you set something down, you're not really transcending it. So the whole vocabulary of pseudo-spirituality and philosophy and stuff is really very much dualistic and off the mark and misleading. They're not aiming for transcendence. We've got to transcend our human condition. No. We need just to say, recognize it's all a scam and decide, you know, it's not what we really want. And it will never work. It's not what we really want. We don't need it. Therefore, we don't really need it. Don't need it. So first have it symbolize no outcomes, and then God will take the final step of just, you know, knowing this. We will once again be just pure knowingness, even though we even are now. We're trying to pretend we're not. So in other words, all pretense will ultimately be gone. We'll set it down. Not through transcending anything. That's not what we're after, transcendence. You know, you can use the term, but it's quite misleading. Any term can be misleading, but that one tends to have a lot of, it's misled a lot. A lot of one, particularly misleading. So again, we're not really after being hippies. We're not transcendentalists. We're not Boulevardier hippies. We'll be, you know, everyone's going to be, this is the direction that, I mean, young people are now so drugged. They're so used to it. I don't know how many young people are not already fully accept the idea of taking drugs of some sort, whether it be pharmaceuticals or ethnogens or whatever it is, right? Me, I don't take anything. Don't take anything. I've been pressured into taking a few vitamins for my eyes. Oh, okay. You know, it's not a big deal. But I don't really put much stock in anything. But young people, oh no, I mean, they start out, I mean, you gotta take this, inoculations, this. So it's easy for them to accept this change that's happening, that's going to happen, that will happen. Easy for them. I say, well, that's just a normal life. What's the big deal? And they look at the older people like, we're crazy. We're not crazy. Guess what, folks? We're not crazy. Neither sane nor crazy, but wowish, very wowish here. Nailing it, seeing it as it is, you know, which is wowish. That the real goal, along with population reduction, that's also part of the situation. The real goal is to make us indolent, and that we want to have our surroundings and structure everything in such a way that we can be non-industrious and indolent. And it's going to be a manufactured indolence through drugs. And that can only last so long. If you some have already been through this whole program, this whole scheme, starting in the 60s, ultimately starting in the 20s, the roaring 20s, which resurfaced in the Beat Generation in the 60s, and really kicked into high gear in the 70s and 80s, with cocaine came in the picture, and then crack cocaine in the mid-80s, let's just be drugged out, man. This is what's coming to on a global scale, on a legal scale. This is why it's completely more intense than before. It's interesting, in the dream I saw this dust was so heavy nobody could go anywhere or do anything. Wow. Now we're really, really clarifying it here. Well, you could say the dust represented this heavy haze. It was a heavy haze. What do you call someone who's in a heavy drug-induced haze? They say they're in this drug-induced haze. They're all kind of hazy. And nobody could move. Nobody said, I said, what? They said, yeah, we're still alive. We're still living, but it's like we can't go anywhere or do anything. This is what they told me. After I fled from it, I came back and I looked. I said, hey, you all right? What's going on? They said, yeah, we're still alive, but we really can't move or go. We just do anything. We're just kind of indolent. We're just sitting here. And there was this heavy haze that I symbolized by dust, which meant drug-induced haze. Wow. Purple haze. It was actually a brown haze. So it was more, you know, opiate-related in some way. But it symbolized, wow. Wow. This is so extraordinary what's taking place here. You know, detective work, you know, relentless detective work. And it's the dreams, and the dream is now. I'm seeing, you know, what this dream was about. Likely. Because you would think that the collapse is so severe, and all these boulders flying everywhere, which might be indicate, you know, activism, great change in activism, and a breaking down of previous notions and beliefs, etc. It didn't kill anyone, so I was surprised. I said, "How did you survive? You know, you didn't." They said, "No. Somehow the boulder, you know, we're still alive. This is what was so amazing about the dream." So I said, huh, how's that possible? So it just represented the falling apart of our resolve, our spiritual resolve, which then led to them being just, I saw there was no industriousness present whatsoever. They said, we can't go anywhere. We can't do anything. We can't really see what to do. You know, this is a drug state. Maybe the brown, the dust, represented caffeine too, which combined with other drugs and with an ideology can make you just feel like, I just feel like sitting here. Or you can become very industrious about doing, about just tweeting, you know, or texting or something, along with the other drugs. So this is likely what this is all about here. And the you know, there's this parallel agenda to Agenda 21 that, you know, there's all the United Nations, nice, all the wonderful stuff. But there's this huge parallel agenda around the world of legalizing drugs and saying there's nothing wrong with drugs and total Sodom and Gomorrah world in terms of sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Huge, especially among the younger people. And they say, well, anyone should be able to have sex with anyone under any conditions. It doesn't make any difference. This is a lifestyle they're pursuing. This is a lifestyle that is designed to cut carbon emissions. Love the one you're with. And it's designed to cut down home ownership and marriage. See, it's actually, you know, marriage is what's under attack, because marriage and in the nuclear family, it's all about, let's build a new house, let's move out, let's build our own house, have our own yard, have our kids, and be industrious. It's the heart of industriousness, actually. If you look at the older generation, I'm always marvel at their industriousness. It's so extraordinary, especially in California. They keep their houses up. My God, they're always remodeling. They're always doing something. I know how much work they put into it. Of course, they hire people to do it for them, but not, a lot of them do a lot of the work themselves. It's extraordinary industriousness, and it's all about the nuclear family. So what they're trying to do now is break down the nuclear family, which is why gay marriage is so important. It's so globally important. This is like one of the cornerstones of the new global culture, new world order, is gay marriage. This is why they fought for it, demanded. It's so important. Is, let's not even have children. Let's just live a lifestyle being of drugs, sex, drugs, and rock and roll. This is what they really want for everybody. And of course, gay lifestyle is notorious for that. Anyone who says differently is simply a liar, you know, plain and simple. If you really research the history of it, you know, it can be a very indolent lifestyle. It lends itself to that, easily can lend itself to that. It certainly, you know, it's not always that way, not always, but it certainly can lend itself in that direction very easily, very much so. And what they want is, they want to break down the nuclear family. So hey, just have sex with everybody, whoever you're with, love the one you're with. It's all good. Let's just hook up culture. You know, go down to your cafe, meet someone in the cafe, go to your little flat, have a fling, have an affair, and just have serial affairs like this, and don't have any children, and just live this lifestyle. This is what ultimately they're aiming for. Now, for people who are nuclear family, very industrious, this is horrifying. It's absolutely revolting to them. And again, I'm neutral on this issue, because for me, it's the spiritual path lifestyle that I'm advocating. But I can, for sure, this lifestyle is just seen as hellish, Sodom and Gomorrah lifestyle to those who are very industrious, nuclear familyness, which they're the ones being blamed for global warming, of course. And this is not necessarily off the mark either. So it's a very, you know, nasty situation, which can be resolved by the WOW spiritual path is ultimately the remedy for this. But I see that the nuclear family, traditional marriage, nuclear family, industriousness, those are the ones who are in the crosshairs of the New World Order, and they're the ones who are really going to get hammered by this. And it is true. I mean, I see all the time these wealthy people. My God, they use so much resources. Their houses, just gigantic houses and yards. And I mean, we're in this drought here in California. The rich people are still using water like crazy. And you ask them about it, and they say, "Oh yeah, sure. Well, I pay for it. I pay a lot for it, and that makes it okay." So they do use a lot of resources. It's you know, indisputable. I mean, the upper middle class American family, which is the one who's been blamed for the global problems, they do use a ton of resources. Absolutely. They're always remodeling, they're always changing, then, you know, cutting down forests, of course. Absolutely, that's true. But they see that as they're doing what God wants them to do. And of course, now there's this new group that says, no, that's not what God wants you to do. And in fact, they're saying, there is no God. So how can you say that's what God wants you to do? There are these two factions, you know, they're saying, hey, you got to stop that. You got to just get some chair, you know, in some gas station and watch the folks pull into the gas. Well, there wouldn't be gas stations then, electric recharging station. And just kind of hang out there at the diner, the little diner. You eat your hamburgers, you smoke your pot, eat your hamburgers, drink your milkshakes, drink your coffee, chat, talk a little bit, and then wander back in a drugged haze and have sex if you can. They'll have stimulants. Well, they have all these, you know, pills now that enable you to do that, which is part of the whole thing. The Viagra and the female sex pill too. That's also a key component, which is why they're pushing that. They push the. I think Viagra's got to be the number one advertiser on television and magazines now. It's just an insane push for this. That, hey, everybody, you know, don't try to remodel your house. Just have sex. You know, use drugs, have sex, and they want to, you know, channel everything into that. Sodom and Gomorrah. Sodom and Gomorrah. Sodom and Gomorrah. And of course, the nuclear family, call them religionists, say, well, look, well, God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. So obviously God doesn't want that. God wants us to be very industrious. You know, be fruitful and multiply and engineer the earth. And this is what they feel God wants them to do. Of course, modeling on the Elohim or the extraterrestrials, really, certain types. Thinking, yeah, we need to, you know, re-engineer. I mean, there used to be great engineering projects far in the past. They've discovered some of those. Crazy stuff. Canals, water engineering products, ancient history, going back way back. Some in Russia, I believe, they discovered some. So we've always been engineering this world. Humans are want to be in, you know, there's been always tremendous industriousness. But now they're saying, we can't do that anymore. Can't do it anymore. So anyone who's industrious is now the evil, wicked, the devil. For the young people, view the older people as devils. Really, they do. They say, if we could just kill them all, everything would be fine. Of course, they're all going to die. Most of them are going to die anyway, unless they take the spiritual path and recognize it's all just an appearance. How are we doing here? We're almost finished. So I'm trying to make it as much as possible in here. Of course. Abidance, what is abidance in? It's abidance in everything and nothing. Some industriousness right there. Wow. That was quite an unexpected disruption. This huge dog came just charging right past. Holy cow. Chasing a cat. So, you know, yeah, it's an agenda. This is the agenda. And the women are all saying, hey, guys, wouldn't you just like to hang out and have deviant sex with us instead of building houses and having a family and all this stuff? This is what they're trying to do. They're trying to market this. It's very clear now. This is all part of this survival tactic, really, of humanity. You know, which is, you know, we're not, you know, it is what it is. But it has nothing to do with salvation, actually. And the problem is everybody get caught up in this. When you're drugged out, you're not going to be able to take the spiritual path. This is what I've been trying to say. You have to be sober. You cannot do it on drugs. You have to be very, very aware of the wow. When you're on a drugged out wow thing, it's not going to work for you. Absolutely, it's not going to work. So it is the unintended consequences. Spiritually, it's a disaster. How does that dog charging here symbolize voracious appetites of industriousness and the need to curb those? Maybe that's what it was. Curb your dog right there, right? Because dogs, aren't they very industrious, aren't they? A lot of them. And you see these women now with all these dogs, and what are they doing? They're obsessive compulsive with controlling them. And they're walking the little dogs. No, no, don't do that. No, don't do that. No, don't do that. Don't do that. So the dog's got to be just like these perfect little robots. It's amazing. So the women understand survival very strongly. They have a very strong survival instinct, stronger than men, actually. They realize, you know, there's this issue of survivability going. So they're the ones who have adapted first, and that's why I've said, quote, pardon the word, they've all become whores, basically. Is that they're saying, hey guys, you know, we got to curb your industriousness of going out and cutting down trees. You know, let's tire you out through sex or something, whatever you can do to tire you out and get you interested. And just let's not be so industrious. And you got to circumscribe your activity and industriousness here. Let's not even get married, you know. Let's not have a family. So they've been working on this to an extreme extent since the 1960s, actually. The women are, I always say they're half step ahead of the men in terms of survivability, in terms of human survivability, such. But they're half step behind in spiritual practice. Because they're half step ahead in survivability, this affects their focus. This affects their focus here. Absolutely it does. This is a truism. Because they're half step ahead, they feel they need to keep training the men. They always need to train the men on what's the next step of survivability. What's the next agenda that, you know, men, hey, come on, guys, you're lagging behind here. You need to get with it. So men always feel like they're not quite doing what the women want them to do. Not quite. And when they thought the industrious society, the men think they finally got it. Okay, they want us to build these beautiful homes everywhere and upgrade them all the time and have a great yard and do all this industriousness. And the women said, yeah, it's great. But then suddenly women started changing and said, no, you're kind of out. You don't really get it now. You're bad. You're kind of bad now. The man goes, oh, wow, I thought I was good. Now I'm bad. Because the women were aware of the problem, you know, survivability ahead of, before the men, actually. They have a sort of intuitive, everyone's intuitive about it, but they take it more seriously, actually, because they want their children, their grandchildren, they're focused on that. Just, they want to sustain the world, whereas men say, sustaining the world is not that big of a deal. Sustaining the human race is not that big of a deal, because they have sort of more spiritual intuition. They're more focused on that. You know, women have spiritual intuition too, but they're just not as focused on it. They're kind of multitasking. They're more focused on sustainability, actually, global sustainability. So that's why the UN put women in charge. The UN, women are really in charge. They're special groups. The groups are, first one is women. In the list of United Nations special groups is women, number one. And it's always been that way, the United Nations, because they're the ones who are more in tune with sustainability of this planet. Pretty interesting stuff, huh? And again, I hope you can take this all in the right way. I'm just pointing this out. It is what it is. I'm neutral, and I'm really in the wowness, okay? The basket of wowness is where I'm coming from entirely. So it's not being condemnatory. I'm just pointing out, you know, the facts. There's the dynamics at work. And again, if you see the spiritual path, you realize the sustainability of this planet is really not something you need to be concerned about. It's a complete scam. Ultimately, it will be set down. Okay, this world will come to an end. As D.S. Eliot said, it doesn't come to an end with a bang. It comes in with a whimper. Meaning you set down all circumstance, all belief and outcomes together at once. So it's not a kaboom ending to the universe. It's just a smooth, not even a whimper either. It's just a completely smooth, wow. Just as we go into abidance in the symbol of no outcomeness, vision of oneness. I like to say this: the symbolization of no outcomes. When we go into that, it's smooth. We just shift into it, just like that. It's as smooth as your automatic transmission on your vehicle. Okay, it's that smooth. You hardly notice your car shifting these days, do you? It's really just a smooth shift, but it does shift. It does shift. And that's what we have to look forward to. And the more of us that can take this as a goal, the better it will be for this planet, too, quote unquote. The less we take interest in it, the better it is for it, actually, right? I have no interest in having children or grandchildren or anything. Zero. Just naturally. You know, it's ridiculous. That's helpful, isn't it? I don't have to be in a drug state for that. So, everything's going to happen, and this dream was correct, that everyone's going to be in a drug-induced haze in this world. That's not good for the spiritual path. So, we want to rescue as many as possible. You know, the people think about the rapture, they're thinking, well, we got to go somewhere to be really industrious. They're not going to let us be industrious on this planet anymore. We want to go somewhere where we have a lot of kids, a lot of industrialists, and a lot of push, chopped all the trees down, build this. Well, those aren't the ones being raptured, if there is any such thing as a rapture taking place. They might go somewhere else. Yeah, but that's not what Jesus is coming back for. No. Jesus is coming back for those who realize setting down outcomes, are willing to have this vision of no outcomes, symbolic, all perception is symbolic. So perception of no outcome is symbolic. You know, it's redundant to say it, but it's worth saying redundancy sometimes. In this case, it is symbolic vision of no outcome. That's what Jesus' aim is. That's the aim of salvation. Jesus' aim is salvation for us, of course. So this is what we will. This is what our aim is for. So this is about it. The video is about ready to click off here. We've done a great job here. 50th Jubilee, 50th anniversary of Jesus saying, this is A Course in Miracles, take notes. Come on up October 21st. This is huge. And we are right. We are celebrating it in style by getting this clarity. That's the best way to celebrate it. This is the best gift we can give Jesus. Say, hey, Jesus, look at the clarity we have right now based on what you started 50 years ago. You know, this is the present we give Jesus, you know. I want to give